الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحضور الكريم.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the title of this session is Arab Women from Vision to Leadership.
The truth to be said, women in the Arab world have really achieved a quantum leap in different sectors in the past two decades because of their determination and their illimited ambitions. Although the Arab countries have really made a long way forward in the advancement and empowerment of women, there are still a lot of challenges that still impede women's access to leadership positions. In this session, we will have with us an elite of women who are among the best leaders in the not only in the Arab world actually, but also worldwide. We will try to discuss together how we can empower women and strengthen their participation, whether in the public sector, government sector, or the private sector, based on their own expertise and their success stories in different sectors. We will also listen to their visions as to the future. Before I introduce my dear guests, I would like to mention quickly that we are no longer talking about competition between men and women. Anything that is achieved by women is not a loss for men. All social studies and economists agree that human resources are the essence of economic resources and development. And when we talk about human resources, we're talking about men and women alike. Accordingly, any achievement that is done through women or for women is a plus and an advantage for all. The mission that we need to focus on is not about the feminism or men and men's existence. I have the pleasure to have with us here from the left, Sheikha Boudour bin Sultan Al Qasimi, the chairperson of Sharjah Investment and Development Authority, Shuruq. Her Excellency Ghada Fathi Ismail Wali, Minister of Social Solidarity from Egypt. Her Excellency Sheikha Lubna bint Khalid Al Qasimi, Minister of International Cooperation and Development. Her Highness Princess Amira Al Tawil, businesswoman and philanthropist. If you allow me, ladies and gentlemen, and my dear guests, in this special seminar, before we actually start our discussion and we tackle the themes of our workshop, to listen to this word by Her Highness Queen Rania Al Abdallah. In the name of God, all merciful, the compassionate.
أحييكم أيتها الأخوات والإخوة بتحية الإسلام ومبدأها السلام. فأقول السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن غمامة السواد والحزن حالت دون لقاء بكم، وليس بوسعي في هذا الوقت إلا الاعتذار عن عدم الحضور. فقلوبنا في الأردن تنزف ألماً وغضباً، والحزن يجلل سماءنا، ووطننا كله دواوين عزاء بابننا الشهيد النقيب معاد الكساسبة رحمة الله عليه. إن وطني الأردن يواجه المحنة والابتلاء بالصبر والإيمان والتصميم على محاربة الإرهاب والقصاص ممن يرتكبون أبشع جرائم العصر وأكثرها وحشية. إن الظروف العصيبة تضع الإنسان أمام مسؤولياته، والإسلام مسؤوليتنا وهويتنا، مسؤوليتنا نحن. نحن من تجمعنا المبادئ الإنسانية. نحن من نريد أن نعيش بتعايش وأن نموت مطمئنين على حياة وأعراض أبنائنا. نحن من نريد أن نترك لأجيالنا عالما عربيا مسلما سالما. نحن في صراع ضد الذين اختطفوا ديننا فنسبوا إليه العنف والتعطش للدم والذبح، يدعون الخلافة وهم عمي الضمائر والقلوب. على يمينهم دم الأبرياء الآمنين، وبيسارهم يدعون الناس للالتحاق بشريعة الغاب التي يروجون لها. والإسلام منهم ومن شريعتهم ومن تكفيرهم وإجرامهم براء. المسلم هو من قتلوه واستباحوا دمه، من آمن بأركان الدين الحنيف وأتم فروضه، من بر والديه وخدم وطنه، من وضع الدفاع عن دينه السمح وعن وطنه هدفاً، عاش ومات لأجله، من صعد إلى طائرته وهو يدرك جيداً أنه يضحي بالغالي من أجل الأغلى، حياته من أجل الوطن. فالنجوم التي تزين البدل العسكرية كالتي حملها معه الشهيد البطل معاذ إلى السماء هي التي تبقي ليلنا مضاءً وآمناً، والنسور التي تزين صدور طيارين العرب تحلق مشكلة فضاءً من بصيرة قياداتنا وبعد نظرها للقضاء على الإرهاب بكل أشكاله قبل أن تنتشر أفكاره الظلامية أكثر وتطال بيوتنا الآمنة وتعيث فساداً وإرهاباً في العالم أجمع. الحضور الكريم، لقد اجتمعتم لبحث دور حكومات المستقبل، ولم يكن الوقت مواتياً أكثر لمثل هذه القمة. لن أتحدث عن حاجتنا لواقع جديد استناداً للإرقام والإحصائيات. نحن بحاجة ماسة للعمل، ونحن في سباق مع الزمن لاعتماد سياسات تتناسب والأولويات التي فرضت نفسها علينا، وأهمها القضاء على الفكر الظلامي والإرهابي الذي يفرزه، ليس على الجانب العسكري فقط، بل أيديولوجياً أيضاً، في مجالات مثل تغيير سياسات التعليم في الوطن العربي، ورسم سياسات تضمن تعليماً نوعياً لأبنائنا، وتغرس فيهم قيم الدين الحنيف والوطنية والتعايش والعمل الجاد، ومثل سياسات تضمن خلق فرص عمل كافية لشبابنا لاستيعاب الداخلين الجدد إلى سوق العمل، وتبني سياسات ترعى المواهب والقدرات والأفكار الخلاقة، وكذلك سياسات تضمن لجميع أفراد المجتمع نساء ورجالا مشاركة عادلة لاستثمار كل طاقات أوطاننا ومن جميع الفئات سواء العرقية أم الدينية. إن ما تقدمه هذه القمة من رؤى وخبرات وابتكار تمثل فرصة كبيرة لرسم سياسات ودروب نسلكها نحو واقع جديد للوطن العربي. وما من مكان أكثر إلهاماً على تغيير الواقع من دولة الإمارات العربية المتحدة. هذه الدولة التي لم ترفع إلى السحب المباني فحسب، بل ارتقت بطموح وهمم مواطنيها، وتحولت برؤية قادتها وعمل أبنائها الدؤوب إلى واحة إعمار وتنمية تنافس عالمياً في شتى الميادين. نحن بحاجة لأن نمضي معاً وبسرعة لنصل إلى واقع جديد آمن سمته التعايش والاحترام وهدفه حياة كريمة للإنسان، لنحصن أجيالنا ونسلحهم بقيم ديننا الحنيف والوطنية والعلم النافع. فإن ما يحدث من حولنا هو أكبر تأكيد على أن التطرف بقناعه الديني أو الاجتماعي أو السياسي غريب على قيمنا، لا مكان له بيننا ولا في مستقبلنا الذي نطمح إليه والذي هو اليوم بين أيديكم. رحم الله شهداءنا وحمى أوطاننا وبارك الله في جهودكم المخلصة، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
We start with Her Excellency Sheikha Al-Qasimi.
After following the words of Her Majesty Queen Rania about terrorism and extremism that is undermining religion and the misconcept of dealing with these principles, in some countries maybe, the same thing is happening with regards to women. So we're seeing that customs and tradition in society are impeding women's rights in the name of religion. How do you think we can overcome these misconcepts? The most important thing for a society is in women empowerment when we talk about the education of women. So this is the priority. If a society is based on equality, for example, in access to education for girls right at the early age, I think this by itself is going to put an end to the narrowed vision of gender equality. The most important thing, of course, is when the policy of the country itself, its legislations and regulations, strengthen the role of women and focus essentially on education as the first step. The society that does not focus on girls and female education, you see that after a while, these societies don't provide women with enough opportunities. So education for girls is essential. In the UAE today, of course, in our society, we have seen that education for women has been one of the priorities since the inception of the state. And women were able to access many sectors and job opportunities because of education. And in the UAE, we're trying by providing grants and assistance to other countries to focus essentially on girls' education, whether in countries such as Pakistan, Yemen, or other countries. Among the priorities for us is not just to focus on the role of the UAE and girls in the UAE, but also overcoming our boundaries, so going beyond our boundaries to achieve gender equality, especially in education and through education. There are special programs that are the focus of many caritative organizations, and also this is entrenched in the principles of the state. Your Highness Atawil, in education in many of the Arab countries, girls' education in post-secondary education maybe exceeds that of male students. So, following graduation, we see that we do not have a women's presence equally advanced. So we have education. Education is there. But what are the other obstacles impeding women's advancement in society to become a true partner in society? In the name of God, I have the pleasure and the honor to be with you here today in this summit and with the participation of really this elite of pioneering women. If I may, I would like to say that if we're going to talk about the governments of the future, about pioneering, about women's support, we must mention His Majesty King Abdullah. May God have mercy on his soul, because we lost him not so long ago. And of course, when we talk about His Majesty the King, we are not just talking about a pioneer in development. We're talking about a father who used to say that the Saudi woman is my mother, my wife, my daughter, and he dealt with us accordingly. So he was able to empower women and allow women to access politics, to be a member of the Shura Council, the State Council. So I will not have enough time, of course, to talk about his support for women. But I will tell you a small story about a Saudi woman who is a friend of mine. Her name is Lama. And she was having some problems in court. There was custody issue in court between the mother and the father. And when she went to the different courts and sessions, of course, it was very costly and all of that. But when she studied law under the rule of His Majesty, she was able to provide custody of her sisters and siblings with the mother instead of the father. And she was able to even fight for alimony. So when the leader believes that girls are allowed to become persons that impact conditions and circumstances. This is what we call for. We as Saudi women, what we call for is to follow on this path. And we hope, God willing, that we will be able to see this advancement under the rule of His Majesty King Salman, with his strong decisions that have already reshaped the Saudi government. With regards to His Majesty King Abdullah, we considered him always as a guide for us, as an example to follow. So he has always focused on educating women. But what I would like to add to what you have said is that there should be support for women from the leadership. When we have support for women and from the leaders of a country, we can have access to social, to political, and to economic sectors. Of course, there is a specific understanding of women and leadership. We need to try and see how we can actually reshape and change this thinking. And I have that the elite participation of women amongst us is the best example. We have Arab women who are in decision-making positions, and I think this is the best example that we can actually change this mentality. And I think that social media, I don't know, do we have 30% of people here among us that are women? Is that true? They are all going to see the success stories through social media, and I think that this change, this is what we aim for, to change this mentality, the thought, and all of that, but this is based on the leadership, on decisions, regulations, and changing the mentality and celebrating success stories. Your Excellency Ghada Wali, do you think that decisions taken by leaders will help society change the stereotyped image that they have? Because some think that societies don't have enough trust with women. So if there's two candidates for the same job and it's a man or a woman, they're going to select a man. I'm talking here, of course, socially. Such decisions, do you think they can re-strengthen that trust, or maybe regain the trust that is lacking in the potential of women in the Arab world? Of course, policies and leadership have an essential role to play in sending strong messages to societies. However, we need to support such policies and trends with legislations, because legislations will remain. And if there is discord between the leaders, there are rules, there are regulations, there's constitution that will ensure that the laws are implemented. You said education. Education is not enough. The education content, the messages that are being included in curricula, do curricula actually strengthen that stereotype image of women, or does it focus on gender equality? Does it actually celebrate the successes and the success stories of leading women in their own societies? So when we talk about education, we're not just talking about numbers. Throughout the Arab world, I think that girls' education is really high. We have higher percentages. But the content of the education system is highly important. Policies are also important, as well as the translation of such policies into legislations and regulations is also essential, and opening the labor market and the public life to women. So society need not just to celebrate the Arab women who are in leadership positions, but we need to celebrate every Arab woman, from the small farmer to the woman that is working in the local community, in the official government office, and even those that are taking care of their kids at home. So all of these women, these are success stories that need to be celebrated. So women's participation in all levels of society is important, and we need to highlight this in the education messages. And this is where the role of the leadership and the government and the strong messages that we have actually heard being said this morning from His Excellency the Crown Prince, that was focusing on the role of the Emirati women and protecting women and Emirati women and their role. These are messages that are launched by the ministers, and that they are accepted and received by businessmen, by all those who might hate women in the labor market. So they focus on the role of women as pioneers, and this will be followed by the right image that is projected about women in the media, the woman that is really participating in all aspects of the economic and social life, and not just focus on changing the curriculum. Your Excellency Sheikh Abdur, in the UAE in international reports, it is amongst the highest ranking countries. I think that it is number one in procedures related to women empowerment. Do you think that this is the responsibility of a government or the private sector, or is it just related to policies and legislations? Or is it actually based on the vision and the policy of the leaders of the country that should focus on the role of women and men alike side by side? I would like, first of all, to thank all the organizers of this government summit, and I would like to thank my colleagues who are here with us and you, Mrs. Montaha. In order to answer your question, let me first say that today we are more in need, more than any other time, for women leaders. We have heard the words of Queen Rania that we need to see what we see in the world actually today. We see wars, we see political problems, we see social problems, economic issues. Who is leading the world? Men. I am not saying that men are behind these problems, but there should be a bigger role for women in decision making. In decision making, women should have a bigger role, should be a partner of men in all political fora. I would like to thank His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid for being with us here today. And this is a proof of the support of the government of the UAE, especially in our session for women about Arab leaders. We would like to welcome His Excellency amongst us. Your Excellency Sheikh Abudur, you were saying that women should be working side by side with men, given the dark times that the Arab world is facing. Please let me continue, if I may. There should be diversity in decision making. There should be one point of view and a different point of view. There should be a diversity in the boards, in a board of administration, and political and governmental policies. There should be this diversity, and women should have a bigger role to play. When we talk about obstacles, and this is something that was mentioned by my colleagues, I think that there are three main obstacles that impede women empowerment. First of all, society. Second, legislations. And third, women themselves. If you look at society, you always say that behind every great man, there's a woman. And we prepare men since infancy to, if it's a boy, we tell him, you are going to become great. And we tell women, you have a secondary role to play. I think that what we should say is that behind every great woman, there is a man. And this is the role of society in empowering women. The following issue is related to legislations. I always hear mothers say, we have to choose between our work and our children. And this is really unfortunate, because as a mother, I have to choose every day to spend time with my kids or go to work. Legislation should help women and mothers with maternity leave. And we should always exert pressure on women to be successful. And this is the pressure that is exerted by society itself and by women. We need to have women leaders and examples to follow. And I'm very proud of my mother and Sheikha Lubna, who is with us here today, and she is my ideal. Your Excellency, we were talking about the role of women and the role or importance of women in the UAE. I would like to share with you some facts. UAE was ranking first in the Women Respect Index that is issued by the World Economic Forum and 2013. So as I said, UAE was also first in the MENA region as to gender equality in the same report. Another indicator UAE focused on many issues related to women and focused, for example, on women's participation in representing the UAE, for example, in the UN and other organizations, focusing on providing shelter for women and children worldwide from the victims of sexual violence, of human trafficking, providing training for these victims to provide them specific training in languages, in handicraft, and other skills. In 2014, the UAE launched an initiative in the Human Rights Council in the UN in Geneva in encouraging the right of girls and women to education and equal access to education for boys and girls and providing education at all levels. Of course, Your Excellency, Your Highness Sheikh Mohammed being here with us today is a proof that we are able today to overcome the first steps of empowering women. We are focusing more on empowering society through women. And this by itself is the methodology adopted by the government, the empowerment of society through women. I have mentioned at the beginning that the UAE cannot be just taken as an example. This is why I'm asking you, Your Excellency, Mrs. Ghada, to what extent. We all know that every country has its own specificity. I'm going to talk about Egypt, if you allow me. In Egypt, following the what was known as the Arab Spring, we used to see women in the field and in the front lines. And then at some phase, we saw women being thrown back into the second line. And then once again, it is really strong in the front line, whether in Egypt or in Tunisia, and it's changing its situation. In the elections in Egypt, and in Tunisia, we had the strongest percentage of voters amongst women, whether in Egypt or Tunisia, as I said. So the role of women in the Arab countries, in other Arab countries, do you think that maybe here we can generalize, or are we talking about women's advancement individually in individual countries? Let me just say that the role of women differ between countries and depending on the conditions of each country. Of course, women, whenever there are changes that could impact society and families, women, you see them in the front line of the protection of society and family. In Egypt, since 1919, Egyptian women were in the front line. So they were always fighting in the front lines for the rights of women. And in Egypt, in women in 1919 and 1923, and then in the 60s, there was a strong female movement. In 2011, women in Egypt went to the street to call for social justice and equality. And when such justice did not see the light and that the revolution was misused, then women felt that there's a threat to its identity and to its family and to its existence. So women took again to the street and they challenged all circumstances and faced all the risks and stayed in the field in demonstration and insisted on overthrowing a regime that said that it's not going to provide any advancement for women and is going to suppress women. So we're not only talking here about women defending women's rights, but defending social rights and social issues. Yes, we're talking here about the wife, the mother, the daughter. They were not just calling for women's rights that were violated, actually. We were all calling for the right of a society to preserve its own identity, the right of a society and the state to be preserved and protected. So women took to the streets and were in the front line, not just in Cairo. I'm talking in the rural areas, in the villages. They stayed in line for 6 or 7 lines in order to vote a constitution that would ensure equality between men and women and to elect those that were supposed to protect society and protect the nation and preserve its identity. The role of women and their participation was essential. Women insisted on preserving their society and their community. This is why women in Egypt and throughout the Arab world were the ones to make, and still are the ones to pay the highest price for terrorism. Their sons are being killed, and they are the ones who are defending their countries and their nations, and they are the ones in the armed forces that are defending the country and the nation. In Egypt, women refuse any violation of their rights, any violation and threat to its society, to its community, and to its country. Regarding the saying behind every great man, a woman, I would like to ask Her Excellency Al-Amira Tawil, who is behind women? Or when we say behind every great woman, there's a man. Who's that man? Is it the father? Is it the husband? The boss that's providing her with a pioneering role? Who is it? I don't like the word behind. I like to say next to every great woman or next to every great man, there's a woman or a man. With regards to the Arab women and the support by men, since the beginning, and I'm talking here especially about KSA, we had Queen Afa who had supported education next to King Faisal, and then Queen Noura. And His Majesty the King used to say, I am the brother of Noura. So she was the one he recourse to get advice. So in the Arab world, you're going to see that women were always alongside men and were always consulted, and they were in decision-making positions. When we say why do we have a lot of success stories for women in our societies? In truth, I believe in social media, in all honesty, and the access to information. So social media has created a platform that would allow us to have access to stories that we never would have had access to. So we know about dreams. We know about maybe positions that girls never dreamt of accessing, and they were able to overcome all the barriers and all the shackles of society. When we talk about Arab women, we need to remember that since our early history, men and women have worked alongside each other. Women have been alongside their men. Unfortunately, as Her Excellency Queen Rania have said, those who were kidnapped. We're not here just talking about the misuse of religion, but destroying the mentality of women is taking even the whole religion, a whole society as a hostage. And this is something totally different. This is something that we need to focus on. We need to develop the Muslim women mentality. When I say to people that I am Saudi, they're always surprised. Why? We have culture. We have resources. We have education. We have staff. We have women that are in the judiciary, that are in the executive power, that are even in the legislative power. Why do they look at us as Saudi women in such a condescending way? We as Saudi women, before anyone else, we need to take the advantage of being in such platforms in order to explain to people who are Saudi women and what they can achieve and what they can still achieve in the future.
In your opinion, when we read news or through social media, and we see a news saying, for example, that a Saudi woman has achieved something great in a certain field, or that they are among the biggest proportion in a certain board of administration. And on the other hand, we hear a news saying that the proportion of women who spend billions to buy accessories and clothes are also Saudi. Why, in this case, only the fashion news stick in the mind? Where do you think the reason for that lies? I have no experience in this. I think, in my own opinion, that when talking about the Gulf woman, there is a study undertaken by McKinsey, and I have said this in Abu Dhabi Media Forum. We have a certain percentage of participation for women in the executive levels of less than 1% in the Gulf states. It's less than 1%. It is very low overall in the world, in Europe and the United States as well. But in the Gulf, it is less than 1%. So once again, I think we should have the ambition to reach at least 2% next year. And we would be happy to see this being achieved in the UAE first and foremost. Sheikha Lubna, in 2012, at the Council Ministry, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed said that the companies and the enterprises should commit to employ women. So sometimes there is encouragement, and on the other hand, the legislations are also very important. So in this respect, in particular, I think that it is a particular challenge, even for the developed countries. And consolidating the position of women is a challenge. Of course, the UAE was a pioneer in this, and I agree with you. I had a colleague, an American colleague, who wrote on the internet and said, how come the UAE issued such a decision before the United States did? Here I would like to ask Her Excellency Ghada about the legislations and the laws. Is the quota issue beneficial and useful in this respect? Can it change opinions? There are two opinions. One that says that gender equality means that there should be a specific role given to women. But if we look at all the experiences, whether in the Western states or in Northern Europe, we see that women have achieved successes with a positive role being to the, given to them. And this would push the society to review her her role. So after that, the society would become accustomed to seeing a definite, a special role given to women in, within the parliament or others. And this is not based on the fact that it is just a conflict of power. So the conflict of power that is always stereotyping the women, I think it could be overcome by this positive discrimination, whether by specifying quotas in parliaments, in legislative councils for a specific period of time, and until the community and the society becomes used and understands and becomes aware of the importance of the role of women. And as Her Excellency Sheikha Boudour said, this can guarantee for us a safer place, a safer world, and a world that is showing those two visions of the women and the important role that it is playing in the society. So I am with positive discrimination, and I think that it does not really distinguish or separate between men and women, but it is a positive discrimination within certain specific period of times, and this is something that we need for the society to advance and develop. And this would also enhance and focus on the women's performance. Yes, of course, I think that what we agree upon over here is that women are asking for their rights because of their competences and skills, not just because they are women. So we said that education is among the most important factors that allow the woman to achieve gender equality. But what about the personality of the woman? What is the role of education in shaping women's personality on the level of self-confidence, of success, of fighting for her rights without waiting for anybody to achieve these rights to her? What does contribute to building this personality? Because before answering this question, I would like to comment on what has been said by Her Excellency Ghada. Gandhi said that in the past, probably leadership was through muscle flexing, but today it is mostly through understanding each other. And I think that this is very important to find in any leader. I would like to emphasize on this point. Today our session is about Arab women leadership. I am not distinguishing between women and men leadership. A successful leadership is a successful leadership. Whatever the conditions are, it is a leadership that can achieve positive results. However, there are characteristics that are proper to women and that differ from men, because they are different biologically, emotionally, and these specificities are positive points that we have to discuss. In the book Athena's Doctrine, it speaks about these issues and it says that women are skilled with patience, justice, long-term sight, and this in addition to other characteristics as well that are very important to find in any leader. And we also notice that women in general are skilled with these characteristics. And again, a successful leader is a leader who can achieve the expected results, whatever the conditions are, whether he is a man or a woman. There are studies which say that in certain companies managed by women, employees would feel safer. Does this have any relationship with the personality of the woman, or is it because the woman wants to show that she is capable of assuming her responsibilities when she is in a leadership position? You have said something very important at the beginning. You spoke about education. Education is very important. We have to change the way we speak to our girls. We have to encourage them to have leading positions since their early age. And dialogue should start when they are still very young. For example, education is very important, and this starts at home. We are today in a government summit that speaks about the future, but the future starts now. It starts today. So we have to put a plan that would build the future with women and men leaders working side by side. Princess Attawil, how can we measure the development of women in a certain society, in a certain community? Is it through her participation, or through the number of employees, or the leadership position that she is occupying, or through the productivity of this company, whether there is a bigger number of women or men? So how can we measure this on the level of countries, or at least on the level of the Arab world? Because we can speak about the Arab world as a whole. I think that all factors that you have mentioned are important. When we speak about women, especially in such a session, we are speaking about a very important partner, an important partner in a successful development. And we have also to look at the social development. Most of the companies in the charity field are led by women. And as Her Excellency Sheikha said, this is due to the emotional intelligence that women are skilled with. I think that on the level of emotional intelligence, women are more skilled than men. And if we compare the social development, if we look at the social development, we have to remember something very important. And this is not something new in the UAE. I think that the reason behind the success of the government is that they compete with the private sector. And this applies to innovative companies and enterprises in the private sector. I think this is very important. It is not only up to the government or the private sector who are important factors in the social development, but we have to speak about social leadership as well. There is no study in Saudi or in the Gulf as a whole or in the Arab world until now that gives you precise statistics about social leaders. We have studies about social development in general, but not about social leaders. Why is this important, and how is it different from social development? Social leaders are persons who have established profit or non-profit organizations in order to come up with innovative solutions. So it is a person who thought out of the box. If we compare the field of social development in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, we are going to look at Saudi Arabia, and we see that 0.5%, so less than 1%, work in the field of social development in general, whether traditionally or an innovative way. If we take social leaders in the United States of America, for example, without social development, just leaders, we see that for each Saudi person working in the field of social development, there are 38 American people working in the States. This is what allowed the countries to develop. So having faith in the future, having faith in the way we will solve our problems, and in this we do not depend only on governments. We depend also on leaders who can think out of the box in order to find innovative solutions. Since the UAE is a country that is considered to be the first in the field of researches and development, and since in Dubai we have the humanitarian city, I wish there could be a study that would survey the social leaders in the Arab world to know who they are and how we can use them as models. I don't think this is something that depends only on women. It depends on both women and men, and I think that this is very important, and our center in Saudi was established for that purpose. So we should know who are the social leaders and how we can support them and work with them. Within the same context, what applies to social development in the Arab world or the women's role applies as well on the other topics in the Arab world. If we speak about scientific research and development, for example, the proportion of expenses in this field, there are a lot of countries like Tunisia, the UAE, etc., where this percentage is high. But if we look at the percentage of spending for scientific research and the percentage of contribution of the private sector to scientific research is extremely low. And it is not to be compared to India or China, or it is really a very low percentage. So the private sector is completely separate. Does this also apply to social leadership, the role of women, and the development of women's role in the Arab world? Of course, the UAE example is probably better than others. So, but how do you view this in general? I will get back to this point, but first I want to comment on the emotional intelligence mentioned before. Regarding the point that you mentioned, we are looking today at the future of the countries in the Arab world. The theme, the main theme of this summit is the future. So it is important that we keep in mind understandable standards. So insisting on the role of women is very important because of the active role of women, whether at home or in the sphere of work. So it is very important if we have any statistics or figures that can help in changing the policy of an Arab country in order to empower women in the Arab communities. I think this is very important. And here I would like to go back to emotional intelligence. Just to clarify the definition of this concept, emotional intelligence is a new science that started more than 10 years ago and appeared in a lot of books and conferences in the world. The emotional intelligence is often linked to women, but this is not the real definition. The emotional intelligence is the capacity of any individual to understand the specific issues, emotional issues, and to use somebody's own emotions to enhance its future, in addition to using this issue for the best and the interest of the enterprise or the community or the society in a positive way. So it is not a question of being emotional, but in the physiological study, it is said that women can more easily build bridges on this level, and the emotional intelligence among women is probably higher. So again, to this is a simple definition of emotional intelligence. But of course, emotional intelligence, we find it in both men and women, but there should be no stereotype or wrong understanding of this concept. One last word, Her Excellency Ghada. I think that figures do not really reflect the reality, especially in Egypt. The private sector is two-thirds of the economy, and the role of women in the non-formal sector is much more important than her contribution to the formal sector. If we look at the percentage of unemployment, among women it is fourfold the unemployment among men. And in small and medium enterprises, we notice that the role of women is extremely important. important, they are highly present, and the obstacles to the entrance of women and her participation in the formal sector have led her to work in this non-formal sector. There are no specific studies that reflect this reality and this part of contribution. So again, the statistics reflect only part of the reality, and they do not always contribute to understand what is really happening. In such sessions, we always want to say that our main objective is to keep moving forward with trust and confidence. And the development of the social development can only happen with the development of women in various sectors, in various fields, and various industries. And of course, this government is probably the best forum to discuss such issues. In conclusion, I would like to thank the participants, Her Highness Princess Amira Tawil, Her Excellency Sheikha Lubna bin Khalid Al-Qasimi, Her Excellency Ghada Fathi Ismail Wall, and Her Excellency Sheikha Budur bin Sultan Al-Qasimi, Chairperson of Ash-Shuruq in Sharjah. But I would also like to thank all the audience and the presence of His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al-Maktoum.